And welcome back inside MMA. Sometimes you just got to take matters into your own hand. We have the best in the business with us today. Big John McCarthy, Herb Dean, Steve Mazzagatti. Glad to have you guys. We continue to talk about refereeing and judging and all this. And we saw there from some of the action, you know, you got to be ready. You got to be physical. And all you guys have fight experience, training experience. I imagine it comes in handy, Herb. Nice tackle, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
You look like a linebacker.
Oh man, I felt actually I felt like I was on a sled. I felt like I was being dragged around.
Trying to pick up a 285-pound man is not easy.
We're going to take a look at some late stoppages here, and I want to point out, because I'm not ever going to put you guys in the position, and I wouldn't if they were here, the other referees. So now we're trying to single out and pick on a referee.
No,
because number one, you don't want the job. Everybody says you want the job, but trust me, you don't. These guys do not drive fancy cars. I've seen their cars. Now, here we have it. This is Bellator. This is a Curran-Warren fight, which became rather legendary.
Yeah, the fence is holding him up.
You know, and that's all that's holding him up. And, you know, then we can move on. We keep showing all these. This is Zaromski's getting knocked out by a Korshkov. But, and then we wrap it up with Kim Couture. This is back at, was it, Axe Combat 1 when Sheila Bird.
Yeah, Marco Hua showed me that joke, actually.
Choke. Yeah, the scissor choke.
And,
I mean, it's like the scissor choke and the scissor choke, and, you know, she's gone. And so they had to revive her, and as you can see, they're working on her right there. So the point is, it's tough, it's bang-bang, as we know, we've heard from you guys. Let me just ask you, is one of the toughest things when somebody's maybe like turtled up or they're on their back or whatever the situation, as to how responsive they are to when to stop that fight, you know, if they're getting
tough.
Is that one of the, to me, it always looks like the toughest thing.
The easiest time, and I hate to say this because of what you showed with that, but the situation where you saw with Sheila Bird and Kim Couture, I know the referee that was involved with that. I have actually worked with that referee as far as teaching him and stuff after that fight occurred. And, you know, everything is in that situation. That was a situation where you can see her eyes, and you can, if you're experienced with that choke and understanding the choke, because a lot of people looked at it and said, oh,
she's
that's
awake.
Nothing.
Yep.
That's nothing. Well, it is something, and especially you get into guys with big necks compared to female fighters that don't have a large neck. It's a completely different type of choke. And that situation went to where he's looking at her eyes and he's thinking that she's awake, when you can look at not only her eyes, but you look at her body structure, and her body structure breaks down, showing you that she's out. And it's all about having that experience and understanding the choke and understanding what someone really goes through when they go unconscious.
And fighters, that was key what you said right there, because I think that's where you often see referees make that mistake, is by continuing to focus on the face, because that's where everything's happening. You're looking at the face, where
the
what's going to tell you, the body is what's going to tell you the person's unconscious.
And usually,
when they're basing or posturing,
you'll get those positions that we get into at times where the fighter's face is down, you can't see it. And so your whole thing is to understand you can't, everyone wants to tunnel vision in on, oh, this, hold right here. And you learn after a while, I want to actually broaden everything and look down that person's body, because that's what's going to give me the information on when this person goes out or if they don't.
And the fighters have some responsibility only in this sense that you do have meetings beforehand. It's not just when you get into the cage or the ring that everybody sees. You know, they talk about these things long before you guys get in there.
Long before.
I mean, you tell them also, they have to kind of at one point let you know when guys jump up and say you stopped it too soon, especially on a submission or something. I wasn't tapping or the question about that. I mean, don't they have to kind of get involved a little bit, let you know that they're still in the fight?
Those are very important, and we always, we go over it in the rules meeting. We have individual one-on-one rules with the fighters, and the two things that the fighters know the rules. The things that we want them to understand in those meetings is, when I say this, this is what I mean, and this is what I expect to see. When I say fight back, that means I'm worried about you. I'm going to stop the fight. I'm thinking about stopping this fight. If you don't want this fight to stop, you need to do something to show me that you're still in there. You need to give me an excuse to let this fight continue.
And you repeat that line a few times, right? That's the most used one, I guess.
Well, the whole thing that people, when they hear rules meetings and stuff like that, the rules of MMA, when we talk about the unified rules, there's 29 fouls there. Well, it's not about going down those fouls. It's about the bout conduct. And when, like what Herb's saying is, look, when I say this, this is what it means, and this is what I need out of you to have me allow you to stay in this fight. Mm-hmm. I need to see that you are at least trying to stop what's happening, trying to change the position, make it to where your opponent has to change what they're attacking you with. We don't care if they're successful. We care that they're trying, because if they're trying, that means that their brain is still functioning, and we'll give them that chance in the fight. It's when they don't try, or they can't, because they've been stuck in such a position that they don't have the technical skill or knowledge to get themselves out of the position they're in, and they're just accepting damage, we're going to stop the fight.
Yeah, we're going to stop the fight when they can't. So that's why we tell it's important for them to try, because if they're not doing anything, it's because they're hurt and they can't.
That's it.
Right.
Yeah. And at this level, you know, we've all learned off of Big John. He pretty much paved the way for how refereeing was going to go. I've learned off him. Herb learned off him. And so at this level, we're pretty much all on the same page as far as what these fighters hear from us in these big shows. So it's pretty universal. Herb has the same thing. He says the same thing pretty much that I do, along with Big John, because I've learned what, you know, to say from him.
Yeah, I was amazed with the book, with your book. Here, let's get it on. How soon that phrase, intelligently defending yourself. I literally thought it was something from the last 10 years or so, but it was all the way back.
All the way back.
All the way back, he already wrote. Yeah. You got those rules. It's amazing to read. It's really good. Yeah,
and then the other thing about that, as far as our job really is to interfere as little as possible. So when we give those rules, we are telling them those two things are when we're going to interfere. We interfere when we need to stop a fight, or also if the action is stale. Yep. We're going to stand the fight up or pull the guys off the fence. So we don't want to do that, so we're going to talk to them first. That's when you usually hear us talk, protect yourself or show me something.
Yep.
Work. They say work. We say work. They know that we're expecting them to advance their position, or we're going to stand them up and restart them.
The judges have got to have something to see to score the fight.
Yeah.
On that same note, it's not our job to make sure they have an exciting fight.
No.
It's their job. They're the entertainers. Like Herb said, we want to we don't want to get involved. We don't want to stand guys up. We don't want to take points, anything like that. It'd be great if we could just get in the ring, dance around, and look cool, but you know, it's not always going to go that way.
Much more to talk about, but first we're going out to Big John's Ultimate Training Academy. Oof. You've been out there.
I've been there.
As we continue on with the rules of engagement.
The back of the head rule goes from the crown of the head all the way down the spine to the tailbone, and a 1-inch variance on each side, so it's like putting a piece of duct tape straight down, and this neck is also an illegal area to hit. But all of this area here is all legal. If during the fight this fighter is hitting him with a hammer fist and you see this fighter turn his head during that punch, it's not incumbent on this fighter to stop that punch in the middle of the throw. This fighter made that punch illegal by turning his head. We will tell that fighter at this point, watch the back of the head, and we expect them to redirect with a different place. All that redirection is to make it so the punches that he's throwing are legal and we don't have to affect their fight. This is where a lot of people get confused with what is the back of the head and what's not.
Referee Kim Winslow talks about her pioneering career, and the UFC's Mark Ratner talks judging when Inside MMA returns.